have quite a bit of rain last Sunday after church, I believe it was, and it rained all throughout the day. And I had pulled up here to take and set the garbage cans out, because I forgot to do that before I left this before after services. And I pulled up here underneath the awning, and I looked over in the yard, over kind of at the corner of the fellowship hall, and out in the yard, and there was a fountain of water shooting up about 3 feet high. And I thought, oh my gosh, we've had water line break. And I was thinking, well, how, where is the water line? I have to go across over here to the church, and I got thinking, well, wait a minute, that's where the water meter is. That was the gutter that was, and it had come out where the drain was. But, and the reason why I say that, because all of it, not always what it appears at first look, is it? You know, the first thing I think is because that water, I said, I watched it, it started going down and down and down as the rain came out. But I was sure it was a water line break. And sometimes things aren't always what they appear. And we have that. We see that happening today. We're told one thing, and then it comes to find out something's different, truth's different. Something else is going on. And there's a situation in the Bible that's kind of similar to this, where at the end of the story you may say, and this is the title of our sermon this morning, not so fast, not so fast, this is, something's different. So if you would, this morning turn with me over to Luke chapter 18, we're going to look at this Jesus' teaching here, Luke chapter 18 verses 9 through 14, this is where our study comes from this morning. Luke 18, 9 through 14. My Bible has the caption above it, the parable of the Pharisee and the publican. Yours may say tax collector, some of them may say sinner, but we're all talking about, and those are interesting ways to look at that, how the differences in translations relate this man. But it, right, but Luke writes this. And he spake this parable unto certain which trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. Well, that right there should tell us something. That first verse that Luke makes note about this parable. I'll read that again and listen to what he says. He spake this parable unto certain which trusted in themselves that they were righteous and despised others. Two men went up into the temple to pray. The one a Pharisee, and the other a publican. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank thee that I am not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican. I fast twice in the week. I give tithes of all that I possess. And the publican, standing afar off, would not lift up so much as his eyes unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone that exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. So when you look at that story on the surface, you can almost look at it in a different light, really. Not so fast. It doesn't appear the way it starts off. And we're most likely familiar with this story. We're going to look at it in a little different manner this morning. And first we're going to begin with verse 10, talking about the two men. Verse 10, two men went into the temple to pray. The one a Pharisee, the other a publican. I mean, that's benign enough to think about this. One said is a Pharisee, one's a publican. Now one, the publican, or the Pharisee rather, is a well-known, well-respected hypocrite in the community. And I'm just going to call it as Jesus would have called it. You can tell as we read on through that prayer that he was all about the fact that he had kept the traditions of the church, observed all of the right things, made all of the right moves. Everything on the outside is what people would, he wanted them to see, shiny, clean. It was written in some Jewish proverbs that if there are only two people that are ever saved, one of them had to be a Pharisee. That goes to kind of show you the disciples, saying, "The scribes and the Pharisees sit in Moses' seat. All therefore, whatsoever they bid you observe, that observe and do. But do not eat after their works, for they say and do not. For they bind heavy burdens and grievous to be borne, and they lay them on men's shoulders, and they themselves will not move them with one of their fingers. But all their works they do is for to be seen of men. They make broad their phylacteries, and enlarge the borders of their garments, and they love the uppermost rooms at the feast, and the chief seats in the synagogues, and the greetings in the markets, and to be called of men Rabbi, Rabbi." See there that Jesus condemning their actions. Sadly, we have people in our congregations that very much are the same way as a Pharisee is. And on the outside, everything looks like it's supposed to look. They're doing everything they're supposed to be doing and saying everything that they're supposed to be saying. But inside, they're like the Pharisees. They're not following the rules. They're even adding things on to people that God never intended to be added in. And we see that today, sadly. I saw a video the other day. I don't even know what made me stop it. It had something because the title had church in it. And it was of a lady that had confronted a younger lady that was at church. And this lady had followed this young lady into the bathroom at church and was fussing at her over the clothing that the young lady had on. And the way the woman handled it was less than desirable. The way that it escalated certainly was something that was undesirable. It ended up, the last word spoke by the young lady was, "I will never come back to this church." And I thought to myself, what if she never goes to any church? What if this young lady was not saved, and because of the confrontation over her clothing, has her so hard-hearted against the church that she never hears the gospel except Jesus Christ? And as I watched that, you know, and I'm not saying that the lady didn't have good intentions, she just went with the wrong method. But the long-lasting effects upon this young lady, I presume, was probably 18, 19 years old. She may never come to the church again. This wasn't one of fake videos. This was one you could tell it was real. And the lady had concluded it. So that's what I'm saying. Sometimes we get so wrapped up in our own righteousness, and we get so wrapped up in the things that we believe that should never be done, that we don't care a bit to inject that into someone else, even at the expense of maybe running them off from church, which that lady accomplished. And we think about that when we think about these Pharisees and why Jesus, in fact, condemned the Pharisees. Now, the other man, the publican, the tax collector, or the sinner, as they said, according to whatever your version says about it, he was well known as well, because he most likely worked for the Roman government, and he collected taxes. Sometimes he collected more taxes than was due, and he would give Rome their share, and then he would keep his cut. And the people knew about this, and the people didn't like the fact that there was a Jew working for the Romans. Well, how do you know he's a Jew? Well, do you remember where it said they were at the first of the first verse? They were in the temple. So if he wasn't a Jew, he wouldn't be in the temple, and he certainly wouldn't be praying to God. So this man was well known and not very well liked, this publican, this guy who worked for the government. We don't know that this particular man stole money, but we can presume that because of the reputation. If you recall, Jesus was even referred to as one of these kinds of people in Luke chapter 7, verses 33 and 34. He's teaching here, and he's talking about, actually it's John the Baptist and him. It says, "For John the Baptist came neither eating bread nor drinking wine, and condemning. This is the Pharisees again condemning John the Baptist, the forerunner of the Messiah, and they're condemning or putting Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of Man, as he says here, in the same classification as those most despised in Jewish society. So that's who this publican is. Sometimes we have a tendency to do that too, don't we? We like to place people in certain places of society because of their, where they live or where they work or how they dress. And that's what we see here. You see this person that society looks as kind of the dredge, the disliked and not cared for. But what we have to remember and realize is this. At one point in time, prior to Christ, I'll say, our condition is no different than this publican's condition. None whatsoever. I don't care if he was raised up rich or if he was raised up poor or raised up somewhere in between. That doesn't matter. What does matter is the fact that we are all sinners and fall short of the grace of God, the glory of God. And I think that's what Jesus in this parable is trying to teach us and make us realize. But oddly enough, they had something in common. Did you catch it? They mentioned it a minute ago. These two men, this publican, who's not liked, and this Pharisee, who's probably not liked, but nobody's brave enough to say it, they have something in common. Where were they at? They were in the temple. They were at church is where they were at. So they had that part in common. The fact that they were gathered there, it was important for them to not forsake the assembly, as it says in the New Testament, but they acknowledged the importance of coming to worship or the temple or to church to seek out God. Of course, with the Jewish religion, that was what you did. And come to the temple to pray. With Christianity, we can pray wherever we are, whenever we choose. But we see here there was different consequences. One was external, one was internal. One came for mercy, but the other came for that external show. So they were both in need. One really didn't know it, and the other did. And we have those types in church too. We have people that come here each and every day, each and every service that we have that are in need, that has a problem. We don't like to think about that sometimes. It makes us a little uncomfortable to think that maybe our neighbor, our friend sitting next to us, that we've sat next to at church for 2 years, 10 years, 20 years, 50 years, whatever the case is, that everything's okay. But we most likely, everybody here this morning has something that's troubling. One way or another. And we have to realize that that's why we come to church. It's because we have needs. We want hope. We want support. We want prayers. We want to know that things will be okay. That God has things in control. And we'll see that in these prayers. Look on in verses 11 and 13. The two prayers that we see praying. Verse 11. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus with himself, God, I thank thee that I am not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican. Could you imagine if we had someone that walked in our church that was a visitor, or maybe they'd been coming here a time or two and they hadn't been saved, and one of our men that prayed during our opening prayer said something like that. Could you imagine? And I'm thankful that I'm not like this old trash over here. Why, we'd flat pass out. I hope. Anyway. But listen to the arrogance in what he says. I fast twice in the week. I give tithes of all that I possess. He's really big on himself, isn't he? Really big on himself. There's no, what do you not see there? You see bragging, you see some arrogance in there. Any confession of sin? Past or present? Wrongdoing? Not there. Any expression of love for his fellow man? expression of love for God. I mean, he is a Pharisee. He is one of the people that they turn to for their spiritual guidance. Nothing. It's all about him. He's not like these sinners. Thank you for that. I'm not an adulterer. Not a wine bibber. Not a publican. Not a sinner. I tithe of everything that I do. I attend church like I'm supposed to. Well, look at my phylactery, which is that reminder that they keep. I don't know if that picture. Yeah, see that box on his head? And the garments that they have, they would make those bigger so they could be identified easier. He wants to be identified, wants people to see him, wants to exploit his own righteousness. Notice I said his own. That's not a prayer that we really want to be associated with. It's actually an excellent example for us as Christians how we should never be seen. And I mean never. Should be able to relate to that. But unfortunately, we have people, and we're all probably guilty of it a little bit. At some point in time, we get a little too wrapped up in ourselves. And we find a little bit of Pharisee coming out of us. And that's when it should be alerted to us. And we should be thinking, wait a second, I need to back up here. I need to punt. I need to make sure that I'm not being associated this way. And then you have the publican. Because if we got too much Pharisee, like the video I was telling you about, you know, we can really do way more damage than we can ever do good. And you can sometimes do damage so much that it's irreparable for people. Look at the publican. Look at his prayer. And the publican, standing far off, would not lift up so much as his eyes unto heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. That wasn't no big, long, fancy, look what I've done kind of prayer. I mean, that guy's humble about that. He won't even look up. He's in the back of the church, in the very back corner, somewhere where he won't be noticed, and someplace where he's likely not to be talked to because he's really embarrassed about the situation that he's in. He's uncomfortable because he's at church, but he knows that church is the only place that he can come for with any hope. And he doesn't know what to pray except that he knows that he's a sinner. And he just asks God for the one thing that only God can give him, and that's mercy. He says, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. And that's each and every one of us. Every day, folks. Is that we seek out that same kind of grace from God that he is merciful to me, a sinner. And that's what we see this man coming here doing. He comes because he had no hope, but he knew that the only place that hope was available was there in the temple. And it's here for us, and it's the church. It's not just this building, but it's what this building, the knowledge that the people that come to this building, it's the knowledge that we have that can give people hope. I mean, the churches are great. It's awesome that we have a nice building. It's comfortable in here. Seating is plenty for all the people that want to come. But that doesn't mean that we have to have this building function as the church. I can tell you about Jesus standing in the parking lot as easy as I can tell you about him standing in the pulpit. We can tell someone about Jesus as easily in the line at Walmart or Kroger or wherever you do your shopping as we can in Sunday school class. And that's the kind of attitude that we have to have. That I'm not going to make this building or this church grounds be the only place that I talk about the Lord. Because if that's the case, then you've got a little Pharisee in you. And you may not even realize it. Because you're just doing things for show. But whenever you have what this guy has is a broken heart. A contrite heart. We'll learn that here in just a second. And we see something quite different in it. Two different men, two different, completely different responses to the Lord. And then what's the result? The result Jesus gives us in verse 14 of this parable. He says, I tell you, this man went down from to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone that exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humbled himself shall be exalted. Now Jesus didn't actually name the name who was justified. Justification, we know what that means. Justified is the action of declaring or making. publican would say, no, I'm not righteous. He said, I need mercy. I just need God's grace. I'm a sinner. So Jesus doesn't actually say the Pharisee, did he? He said, this man. Look at that again. Tells you this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. So that leaves that a little bit open for interpretation, doesn't it? Right up to that colon there. And then what? Everyone that exalteth himself shall be abased, and he that humble himself shall be exalted. So you go back and you look at the examples, and who exalted himself? The Pharisee exalted himself. Who humbled himself before God? Wouldn't even lift his eyes up. Was in the back of the room. The publican. So Jesus pronounces righteousness on the man that has the humble spirit, the humble heart. Not the one that lifts himself up being proud and boastful. And I'm so glad I'm not like this publican sinner man here. And that's what we have to realize. We have to realize the same thing. How would you describe that Pharisee? Think about this just for a minute now. James chapter 4, verse 6. We're going to look at this little scripture here related to the two men and listen. And he's quoting out of Proverbs here. He says, but he giveth more grace. Wherefore, he saith, God resisteth the proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. And that's out of Proverbs. How would you describe the Pharisee? Now, here's going to be a couple tough questions. And I don't mean these to be tough, other than I want us to think. I'm not condemning. I just want us to think and compare ourselves. In light of the Pharisee's example, how would you describe yourself? In light of the Pharisee's example, how would you describe yourself? That's one question for yourself to ask throughout the course of the week, using this example. What about the publican? Publican, on the other hand, remember, Jesus said he's the one that left justified. A broken heart, a contrite heart, one that is feeling of remorse is what that contrite means. Or of guilt. Broken because of that guilt, broken, remorseful. And that's, we don't see that a lot in our society today. We don't see people that are brokenhearted because of their guilt of sin. They try to justify their sin. They want to blame someone else for their sin. You notice that's one thing that the publican didn't do. He didn't blame anybody. It was all on him. He didn't say, "Have mercy, be merciful to me, God. I'm a sinner because of such and such." And we don't see people with broken hearts because of their sin. But that's what the example was. So how would you describe the publican? And in light of his example, how would you describe yourself? So let's give you a lot to think about, a lot to examine yourself. Are you more like the Pharisee or are you more like the publican? And remember, this publican was somebody that was despised in their society. But that's exactly who we should be more like than the Pharisee. And I think that's what Jesus is teaching here. Now, I'd venture to say we have more people walking in here again that have troubles in their life than they do living the perfect life that has no troubles. No worries, no problem with any kind of sin. Everything's smooth sailing. You ever thought about that? We don't like to pry into people's lives. And I'm not saying you start doing that. But what we need to start doing is looking at people and thinking, you know what? They probably got something that's bothering them that I don't even know about. They've probably got something that's weighing them down, a burden of some sort, and I'm going to try to be kind to them. Offer them a kind word. Tell them that I'm praying for them. Maybe the Lord put it on your heart to pray for them. Let them know. The Lord put it on my heart to pray for you. Don't know what's going on in your life. Don't know if anything's going on in your life. I just wanted you to know I love you and I'm praying for you. And that may be all it takes to switch somebody's day, week, life around. We don't know. What's the difference in these men? It's their heart. That's the difference. One's broken hearted over sin. One don't even think he ever sinned. Their heart is what the difference is. Conviction, that work of the Holy Spirit. Now, we've been talking about the Holy Spirit off and on for the past month now, but when you quench the Holy Spirit or you don't feel conviction, you get to be like the Pharisee. Okay? And I think you see the work of the Holy Spirit in this publican. He knows he's got stuff to work on. I've got stuff I've got to work on. If you'll admit it, you've got stuff you need to work on. And the Holy Spirit reminds me of those things daily. And I struggle, and I try to improve each day. So what can we take from this little parable that Jesus teaches? If you declare yourself righteous because of your own prideful work, if you hold yourself in high regard, you're most likely in trouble. If you have self-appointed yourself to point out other people's sins, you're probably in trouble. And if you think you have no problem with sin, you probably have a problem with sin. Because that's what we see this Pharisee. On the other hand, publican, if you humble yourself, acknowledge that we're hopeless outside of God, outside of Christ, outside of the leading of the Holy Spirit, humble yourself, as Jesus said, then you'll be exalted and lifted up. And this, of course, is through God's grace. And Jesus Christ is our Savior, what this is all about. If you realize and acknowledge that even your best efforts are not sufficient, you're on the right track. And that's what Jesus is saying there at the end. He that lifts himself up will be humbled, and he that humbles himself will be lifted. And that's what we have to do as Christians. So there's no shame in being as the publican. There's great shame and danger in being as the Pharisee was. So where are you at today? I want to challenge you to compare yourselves to these two and be honest with yourself and let the Holy Spirit work in your life so that he can help you to overcome either way. Which prayer would you be praying? Think about that. Which of those prayers closer identifies the prayer that you would pray leave here? Or better yet, before you came this morning, which prayer would have been the one that you prayed? Would have you been praying that you're so glad that you don't do these things, that you're not like other people, and that you would be highlighting all the good stuff that you do? Or would you be praying as a publican, I'm just a sinner, Lord, be merciful to me? And we know that all that begins with Jesus Christ as your Savior. You have to have Jesus as your Savior to have the leading of the Holy Spirit because it comes through baptism. So hearing the word, believing, confessing Christ, repenting of your sins, being buried in baptism, raised that new creation, having received the forgiveness of sins and the gift of the Holy Spirit, walking faithful. I didn't say perfect. Jesus never said we'd be perfect this side of heaven. But we can be justified, found righteous in God's eyes when we humble ourselves. Maybe study, you realize, you know what, I've got more Pharisee in me than I can stand, and I need to do some changing. Well, any Pharisee inside of you is more than you can stand. So if you need to come down, either way, we're going to sing a hymn of invitation. If you want to accept Christ as your Savior, if you want to repent, get support of your brothers and sisters in Christ, I encourage you to do that. In either case, we're going to sing Jesus is Calling.